We are going to start looking into another setup in multi-arm bandits called pure exploration today. So where we don't care about regret or what is the reward I'm going to accumulate till some point. Or it may be the case that what I only worry about is whether finally the arm you gave me is the correct, the optimal one or not. Okay, so okay, let's consider an example. So you all know that like before all these drugs are tested on in a laboratory in a lab on some animals, let's say mouse, let's say, or on mice. So what they will do? They will have a set of drugs they want to test and finally identify which is the drug which is most efficient. When they are doing these trials, they will not worry about how many mouse or mice they killed, right? Like because some of the drugs. What they want is at the end, whether I identify the best drug or not, so that when I apply on humans, the risk are minimal. Or that is the most effective drug. But while I'm applying on testing it on the mouse or mice, I don't really care. So what for me there matters is whether did I identify the most efficient drug or not. So during the exploration, I'm not worrying about like how many mouses I really saved. It's fine. Like, as long as that experiment is helping me in identifying which is the good drug, I have full freedom. And similarly, let's say you want to identify which is the best restaurant in surrounding area of Powai. What you could just do is, if you don't care about the money you are going to spend, you just go and eat in every place, every time, and at the end, you have to recommend to one of your friend, or let's say your parents have come and you have to take them. Then you are going to say, okay, so let's go for this. I have already explored, and let's go to this restaurant. So when you are exploring, you didn't care whether you are going to get the best or not, but what you are trying to do is just identify which is the best one. So in this setup, in a way, you are not worried about the regret, right? What is happening? What is the cumulative reward or loss you are going to incur sometime? Now, such problems are usually called as pure exploration problems. And in that also, there are different versions. Okay, so we are going to start with the case of simple regret. Okay, let's recall our standard stochastic multi-arm bandit case. So in the standard stochastic multi-arm bandit case, how did we put our criteria? We evaluated the performance based on the regret we are going to incur. How was the regret defined there in the stochastic we defined regret of an algorithm pi over an environment nu as, I could write it as t equals to 1 to t mu star minus let me just write it as so this is the reward sample you got when you played IT term. I just took the expectation, but IT is still a random quantity, that's why because that depends on all the past observations. So we are going to look at this. Let's take a particular time t. What is this quantity here? This quantity we can treat it as the loss the regret, instantaneous regret I incurred in round T. And regret is what? It is sum of the instantaneous regret you are going to incur in each of these rounds. Now, instead of worrying about what is the instantaneous rounds and how they accumulate over a period of time, suppose let's say I am only worried about what is the regret I am going to incur So, I t plus 1, what is I t plus 1? This is the arm that is recommended by this algorithm after the tth round, that is in the t plus 1th round. You are worried about this. Whatever in t rounds you wanted to do, let us say you did it, but now you wanted to worry about this quantity. And let's worry about the expected value of this quantity. And now this we are going to call it as a simple regret. Simple regret, I am going to write it as simple of what or pi you are going to have. So, till first three rounds, whatever I got, I do not care, but now my performance is defined in terms of what would I have got in the t plus 1th round. Okay, and my goal now I am going to set it as minimize this quantity. Okay. This is so anyone has simple algorithm to minimize the simple regret? What could be a simple way?
Equal number of times.
Okay.
And then choose the arm with the maximum.
Which has the highest mean, empirical mean, right? Okay. So that is what similarly we actually did in explore and commit algorithm also, right? But there we also worried about the entire regret. But let us say I apply the same algorithm here and evaluate my simple regret. Okay. So whatever the algorithm you said, that is a let's call that as a simple uniform exploration. What this algorithm is going to do is simply the first t rounds it is going to spread along each the arm equally, and then at the end it is just going to play the best one at which is best in the sense that which is empirically best. So, for so k here is the number of arms. So, what is mu I hat t is, this is the empirical estimate of arm I you have gotten till round t. Fine. So, you are just doing this, then the question is what will be the simple regret for this simple algorithm, how to bound this. Okay, let us try to get the bound for this. We already have done it. The bound we are going to get is very similar to what we did it in the explore and commit algorithm. I am going to denote by delta I, this is what by our notation, it is going to be mu star minus mu I. Mu star is the mean of the optimal arm and mu I is the just like mean of the ith term. Now let's say it plus 1 equals to r. So let's say I happen to choose it plus equals to ith term. What does this mean? It means that it should be so I'm going to assume that arm 1 is the optimal arm. Okay, so I'm just without logic of generality. The algorithm does not know, but for analysis point of view, just assume that arm 1 is the optimal arm. So let's say so in this case, if I have chosen ith arm, then it must have happened that the mean of this would have been at least equal or greater than the mean of the optimal arm. Okay, then we want to bound what is the probability of this. By the way, how many times each arm is sampled in this? T by k. Let us say t by k is integer for time being. Now how to bound this? Okay. We know this, what is this quantity? This is nothing but, so r, I am going to just write it as mu I hat t greater than or equals to mu 1 hat t. This I am going to simply write it as, so I want this to be greater than or equals to 0. Okay, I did some manipulation here. I know that mu I hat has been obtained by averaging t by k samples of ith arm, right? So mu I hat is nothing but average of t by k samples of ith arms, right? And similarly, mu 1 hat is nothing but t by k average of xi averaged over t by k number of rounds. Okay. Floor of what? So okay, the number of samples I am going to get for both of them.
The total number of times you are going to place capital T, so
yeah,
it should be less than t by k.
Okay, let's keep it like that. Let's say everything for us goes through, and I'm just not writing the indices here, but these indices are, this sum is assumed to be over t by k number of samples, and I know that xi has mean mu I and x1 has mean mu 1, and the difference between their means is del I. That is what I have added on both sides. Okay, but the difference here is minus del I. Yes, mu 1 minus mu I, mu 1 minus mu I is del I, but that's fine. This is the expectation of this is going to be minus del I. But if you look into this, is this a zero mean random variable? Yes, right, it is a zero mean random variable. Let me make one more assumption, that assume that each of the arms have sub-Gaussian distribution, and specifically we are going to assume that they are all one sub-Gaussian, so that the sigma square parameter is one, and they are independent across the arms. So now in that case, what is the distribution of this going to look like? It is going to be simply root 2 sub-Gaussian. Okay. Now, if I am going to apply, so if I am going to apply mu I hat by t and at t greater than or equal to 0. Now, if I am going to apply the property we have for a sub-Gaussian noise, this is going to be exp. So, we have kept it as t by k delta I square divided by 2. So, in the denominator we usually got 2 sigma square, right? But sigma square is what here? It is going to be 2. So, it is going to be 4 now. Notice that the when you are going to do the averaging, right, the number of samples are fixed, the number of samples are no more random, because I know that after t rounds I would have had each the number of samples is this floor of t by k. So this quantity is a deterministic in this case. That is why I could apply my result that I have for the sub-Gaussian tails. Okay, now once I have this, I am now going to bound my regret, sorry, my simple regret. What is my simple regret? My simple regret is nothing but probability that and what is this probability? Probability that I t plus 1 equals to I is upper bounded by what? By this quantity, right? Because this probability that I t equals to 1 is exactly this condition, and we have bounded that probability. So this is going to be like so now to tighten this bound, what we are going to do is let delta be some quantity, whatever you choose, delta be some quantity. Now I am going to split this sum as, okay, maybe like before this I will do this, not here. So I am going to split this sum as sum of all I for each delta I is upper bounded by delta, plus sum of all I for which delta I is greater than delta. I have split it into these two format based on what is the delta I have chosen. Okay, so I know that so this is going to be d0, this is somewhere delta 1, this is going to be delta 2, all the way up to this is going to be somewhere delta k. I have chosen somewhere delta here, and that is why I could split it. I mean, it may happen that delta is beyond this point also. In that case, in this case, it is going to be simply one sum. The second term will not arise. But as of now, I have chosen this delta arbitrarily. Now, this quantity here, I know that this delta is upper bounded by, so the delta is upper bounded by this quantity delta. If I am, then I am going to pull it out, then this is nothing, then it is going to be the sum of probabilities for which this condition holds, but I know that the sum of probabilities can be at most 1. So that is why I am going to upper bound it as delta, but the other quantity is going to still return like this. But in the other other quantity, yeah, I am going to so this one I cannot bound it in the way I have done here because delta is a lower bound on delta is here. Yeah, but I will use the probability term here, bound on the probability. But here, this delta I square I have, this delta I know that this is lower bounded, this delta is lower bounded by this delta, right? So if I replace this delta I here by delta, will I still get an upper bound? So I will do that. Now the way I have chosen this delta here is arbitrary, right? I have just said that some delta greater than or equals to 0. So if I am going to do instead of this min over all this quantity such that delta 0, this bound is still a valid bound. Okay. So this is what we are going to state as a result now, what we have just proved. So I am going to use this notation epsilon sg superscript k 1. This means this is the class of distributions which are sub-Gaussian with sub-Gaussian parameter 1. Okay. So when I say this nu belongs to, this means each of the arm is sub-Gaussian distributed with parameter 1, and k denotes already the number of arms in that. Then for all t greater than or equals to k, what we have just showed is r of t simple regret of this guy uniform exploration is upper bounded by what? Min over now, what does this bound tell us? So, if you look into this, How does the t coming into picture here, the number of rounds? It is coming as negative exponential in this, it is coming as a negative part in this exponent. That is, if I increase t, this term is going to vanish exponentially first, right? So this uniform exploration is going to be asymptotically optimal in that sense, right? Because as I let t goes to infinity, this term is going to vanish, and minimization I am going to take it over del equals to 0, and then this is going to say upper bounded by 0. I know this simple degree is already a non-negative quantity, so it is going to be 0. So this simple algorithm is going to give us a simple regret that is going to be falling exponentially fast in the number of rounds. Central limit theorem, what do you want to say? Yes, so he is claiming like if I am letting t go to infinity, there also I am getting the right means, right? So I should not be making any mistake. The same thing is also being said here. Okay. So when I said this is going to go to 0, this simple regret exponentially fast, that is for a, you fix a environment and then you increase the number of rounds. Okay. But now let us say if I fix the number of rounds to t, and if I keep changing and I am applying, so let us say I will give you fixed t, and I am now asking you to apply it on different environment. So how is that? In that case, if I fix t and if I am going to change this environment, that is the delta i's are changing, what could be the bound on this? So you see that this guy here, if I increase delta, this guy is falling exponentially fast, but it is also, there is an increasing parameter delta i here, right? Because that is going to increase the regret. So let us see, and also there is a delta here. So let us say if I am going to fix t, and let us try to get a problem independent bound here, that is irrespective of whatever delta is, what is the regret I am going to get? One thing you can do is, suppose I set a environment, or let us say if I am going to set my, I am going to choose my delta such that, so delta I said is arbitrary, right? It is just going to be greater than or equals to 0. In this, I am going to choose a particular delta here, in this part here. If I am going to choose a particular delta in this fashion, can you quickly plug in this delta into this equation and see what is the value you are going to get? So delta is going to be, in that case, this quantity is going to be, okay, delta is this. Plus what is this going to do? It is going to, if I square it, okay, just let me plug in myself here. So it is going to be, this is going to be 4, right? 1, 4 get cancelled, this guy get cancelled, I am going to get exp minus 2 log k, I am just going to return it, and this is going to be simply delta i. Will not only this 2 get cancelled with this 4 here? Is it that? Let me just cross verify my calculation. So if I do del square here, it is going to be 4 into 2 log k divided by this quantity. So 4, 4 get cancelled, Is it not because of this 2? This 2 will come return.
No. 2 root 2 log.
2? 2 log. K.
Oh,
I see. Did I? Okay, fine. If it is not that, then this is. Right. In that case, it is simply going to be what? 2 log k, whatever this term, t by k. This is going to be 1 by k. 1 by k, and how many terms here? At most k terms will be there, right? And if you are, and what is this del I? Yeah, it is subgaussian, right? We don't know, like whatever, but let's write it whatever. It is a fixed content, right? So this is going to be k 1 by k. It is simply going to be, in that case, is delta I. One by k multiplied, there is at most this sum can be at most k, right? I just I remove the summation. Okay, okay, that summation is okay. If I am going to keep that. Okay, now let's see if I want to make it independent of this quantity. Okay, fine. So this we don't know like really what is the value of mu i's, right? But we know that these are some finite quantities, okay? I mean, they are not at least infinity, right? So, and so the this del i's are what? The difference between the means. So they are further bounded, okay? So if you are going to assume that all this means are all some finite, then this is going to be just a constant, right? So this summation is going to be some constant in that way. So then I will just write it as, if I assume that the support is between 0, 1, they will all be bounded by 1, that is fine. But here, if I don't, if when I started saying that, I have just said that this guy belongs to a class of sub-Gaussian distributions. So I have not specified about where the support is. If the support is in the interval 0, 1, it is still true, and everything I can bound it by 1, this is going to be a constant. If not, I can always assume that this means are some finite value. For this entire class, I can assume that for this whatever my entire class it is there, right? I can assume that the means are some finite. Once I know that it is finite, then this quantity is going to be bounded in terms of that constant value, okay? So suppose assume that you are dealing with a class of sub-Gaussian noise, right? No, I know there are at most k terms in this.
So then it will obviously be bounded by k times the delta max. So
delta max, yes, but what is that delta max?
So that
is indirectly, right? If I bound mean, delta max is already bounded.
Yes, so you don't need to go through delta max.
So I am trying to make sure that instead of writing delta max, delta looks like a problem dependent quantity, right? I want to just write it down as a constant which depends on the entire class, not for that particular distribution. So as I'm like when I want to trying to write this, I want to come up with a bound which is problem independent. Delta max could be depends on a particular problem instance, but I don't want it to be problem instance dependent. I want it to be a parameter which depends on the entire class, not on the particular instance. See, like one thing is you have this delta i's. You can choose max over delta i's and call it as delta max.
Yes, sir. Even if you let the support to be 0, 1,
that I agree. So there, when I say support to be 0, 1, right, that is not the property of the instant, that is the property of my entire class.
Yes, suppose it is.
So if I do this, in this case, irrespective of what is my problem instance, the delta i's are always going to be 0, 1. That's why delta max is going to be at most 1.
Yes, sir. So you just get k times 1, right?
In that case, yes.
So there is no need of the entire analysis. You already knew it was less than 1.
It is less than 1, right? I'm only trying to deal this part separately.
Yes, sir. star minus mu I t plus 1 will obviously be less than 1 into the 4 star.
And that is fine. I know this. If the support is in the 0, 1, I know this is already between 0, 1.
Yes.
But that I am not making that assumption, right, initially. I am saying the support can be anywhere. That is what I am saying. Like in, when you want to go for problem independent bound, let us say that this class is such that the means are bounded. Whatever, like 0, 1, that is something, but whatever that value is, it is bounded. In that case, I know that this delta i's are all bounded. So then it is going, that is going to give me some universal constant delta max that is only depends on the on this class, not on a particular instance.
Yes, sir, so what
is, yeah.
So the sum of, if you bound delta I by some delta max.
Okay.
And you can say delta max.
Oh, okay. So you are saying that the R max is anyway upper bounded going to be delta max if I are going to. So that's fine. What I want to write it here is, in terms of in terms of the number of rounds, yeah.
Yes. Then the bound we are getting is weaker than what we have got initially.
Fine. Let's figure out that. So what I am going to get is, if I upper bounded by delta max, whatever, right? So that is delta I by k into some part which is not at k.
Yes. Yes.
Okay. So if that is all k agree, then it becomes in delta max. That is a trivial bound I have here.
Yes.
But here, I right now I don't know that is the case, because of that the other part is also there. Okay. Okay. I think this needs a bit more refined argument. So let's see if we can argue that bit later. But fine. Anyway, so if we are going to like have the sub-Gaussian noise, and let's say we have some parameter which defines how large this delta i's are in terms of that, then I can treat this as a constant. And what I have is here a simple regret bound which is of the order log what is this, log k divided by square root of this is what is this, sorry, this is floor of t by k. Okay, then what I want to write this as this, so this is like order, if I just do this manipulation, this is going to be 2 times sum k log k by t, right? I have just taken this k in the numerator, so this is k log k divided by t, if I am going to treat this as a constant here in terms of the problem class dependent constants. So, okay, what we have done here is, we have an upper bound on the simple regret where that is growing that is falling exponentially fast, but this problem is this bound is like problem dependent, like it depends on the particular one. So now if I make it, get rid of the problem dependency by bounding its all the parameter, now I have a constant here where regret is like falling, like the simple regret is falling like inversely in capital T. But this is anyway a constant, right? Like I mean, I am not changing, this is not changing with time, I am only talking with respect to time, how it behaves, only time. So this is going to, if I am going to fix whatever the problem instance, and then you are going to increase t, what is this is saying is your simple regret is going to 0 exponentially fast. But if you are going to treat it across all parameters irrespective of a particular instance, it is saying that there could be a worst case if you are going to treat where it can make you go like only like order 1 by like square root 1 by t. Okay.